So there are really two topics that I want to talk about today, and it really follows on Lori's initial comments. The first is to highlight the many challenges that we're facing right now, and that's related to the economy, the pandemic, what else is happening in society at this time, all of which impacts how we think about the economy. The second thing I want to talk about is one of the programs that we are initiating to try to help mitigate some of the problems. And I'm very pleased that the Boston Fed is working on the Main Street Lending Program. And in particular, that last Monday, we opened up for lender registration. So that's the first step in actually getting this facility up and running. What this facility does is it provides an ability for businesses to get financing through banks, and hopefully will provide an ability for banks that have been challenged by the pandemic to get a bridge to a better time. So it's clearly very challenging economic times. We've recently announced changes to the program to make it much more attractive, both in the features of the program, but also in terms of the Federal Reserve is buying 95% of the loan so that it makes it much easier for the bank to do the financing for this program. So later in the talk, I will spend more time talking about some of the details. This is in addition to very significant outreach we're doing for both borrowers and lenders in the program. And we look forward to having any questions or comments that people have to try to make this program as successful as it can be for both borrowers and lenders. Next slide, Mike. So let me start with the pandemic and how it's affecting the economy. And I think New England, as Lori's comments highlighted, have been severely impacted by the pandemic. So this region of the country was particularly hard hit in March, April, and May. And I think there's some good reasons for why the Northeast was disproportionately impacted. We have cities with great histories. As a result, they're attractive tourist sites. They're attractive for business travel for the same reason. They're transportation hubs. Amtrak links the entire Northeast. And they're education hubs, as great universities like Brown University in Providence highlights. In normal times, all those features are actually great attractions to the city. During a pandemic, it actually becomes a challenge. The reason for that is it's bringing people from all over the country to a location, and as long as the virus is a problem anywhere in the country or actually anywhere in the world, we have to be concerned that our cities are susceptible. I think Rhode Island, like Massachusetts and many of the other New England states, have followed a very data-focused strategy, and I think we're seeing those quarantine aspects actually paying off their dividends for those that are greatest at risk from a bad health outcome. But I think in the longer run, this relatively conservative approach is also going to make our economies much more robust. So while the shutdown was very costly and many businesses were severely impacted, many people were put on temporary layoff or worse, it was necessary in order to help with our overwhelmed healthcare systems that happened throughout the New England region, that our hospitals were badly stretched, the heroic efforts of both doctors and nurses to care for those that had unfortunately been infected was critically important. It also gave us time to get safety protocols, that's for us as individuals, but also for hospitals in general, and give us a little more time to hopefully get to a medical outcome, either with a vaccine or a better drug regimen to actually get us to a place where we don't have to worry nearly as much about getting infected with this virus. Next slide, please. We had a employment report for May, and there was some really positive news in that. So it's obviously always good when we get a better than expected payroll employment number. I think that one of the challenges, normally there wouldn't be any caveat to that statement, but right now there actually is a caveat to the statement because it's important that we open up the economy in a way that is safe and a way that is sustainable. If we don't do that, we're trading off more employment now for possibly less employment in the fall if we were to have a reoccurrence of a significant outbreak of the infection. So as important as it is to open up, it's incredibly important that we do it in a way that we take health precautions, not only to protect those individuals that are most in danger if they get infected, but it also risks undermining investors, consumers, and firm confidence. And many firms and businesses are already in precarious positions as a result of several months of not getting any revenues. So it's very important that we don't have a serious reoccurrence in the fall that potentially forces us to have additional shutdowns, either regionally or elsewhere in the country. I would highlight again from Lori's comments that the pandemic doesn't fall evenly distributed across everybody. It disproportionately affects certain parts of our society, in particular because the pandemic is transmitted between people and it's a respiratory disease. Personal services are particularly affected. So that meant that business shutdowns at restaurants, hotels, retail stores, and tourism were more severely impacted than many other businesses, and that workers in those industries are frequently workers that are people of color, younger workers, and less educational attainment. In a couple of slides, I'll just highlight that if you look at the unemployment statistics, those are the people that are most severely impacted so far, so that it shows up fairly clearly in the data. Next slide, please. So one of the things that is a very positive note is that there's been a very rigorous approach by policymakers in terms of the federal government. Unemployment benefits were expanded. They were more beneficial than traditionally provided. There were other programs that are meant to help businesses. So the federal government has been very good about getting both direct and indirect payments to both individuals and businesses. I think that has been an important mitigating factor. The Federal Reserve is also doing its part. We very quickly lowered short-term interest rates to zero. That means the cost of funds for people that do have to borrow is lower as a result of those actions. We took significant actions in purchasing longer-term securities. That helps with financing. If you're trying to get a mortgage for a house or refinance, it also helps if you're a business that's trying to refinance or get additional financing. And we started emergency lending facilities, which I'll talk more about later in the talk. Despite all the actions we've taken, because of the severity of the pandemic, more still needs to be done. So unemployment is very high, and I'm about to show you a slide on that. Inflation is clearly too low. So in terms of the two things that the Federal Reserve focuses on, both elements are far from where we want to see them. And so we need to be very accommodative at this time. I would highlight that my own forecast is tempered by the continued community spread. So nationally, we have not done as good a job as many other countries in reducing the community spread. That has implications for how strong the second half of the year is going to be. So while I do expect a rebound, if you had asked me in March how strong the rebound was going to be, I would have thought that there was a chance that it could be quite strong. While we are going to get a rebound, I do expect that by the end of the year, we're still going to have double-digit unemployment rate. That is a little more pessimistic than some of my peers, but it reflects my concern that if we open up too quickly, we actually may have another wave of infections that could damage the economy. Next slide, please. So as those of you who've seen my previous talks, I tend to focus on data. And this is a really troubling time for an economist because it's really hard to focus on data. The reason for that is both the spending and the employment data are being impacted by a mix of factors that actually have different results for how you interpret it. So to the extent that spending is down and unemployment is up because of a mandatory shutdown that quickly gets relieved, that's not much of a problem, and that would be the V-shaped economy that many economists talk about. However, if a lot of firms end up having great difficulty If many workers cannot get back to the same job or alternative jobs, then the economic weakness that occurred in the spring of this year is more likely to persist as we get into the fall and winter. So I think it's very important to highlight that whenever we're looking at data right now, because of these two features, we have to be careful to not overinterpret the data, realizing that it's likely to change as all the state mandates start to get reduced or eliminated. So the unemployment rate in the May report was 13.3%. While that was better than people were expecting, I would highlight that that is a very high unemployment rate. So the peak of the great financial crisis, the unemployment rate was 10%. I'm also going to highlight that the numbers are somewhat suspect because they don't fully include all the aspects of the labor market. In particular, because of the pandemic, many people may have answered the survey and misclassified themselves as being employed when they were unemployed. And a lot of people have left the labor force involuntarily. So Mike, next slide, and I'll show you that in a picture. So the first set of four charts, what you're seeing is the dark blue is February 2020. As you move from left to right on the bars, you're moving from February to the most recent employment date. As you can see, the unemployment rate did come down in the last employment report, even though it's at 13.3%. But I would also highlight the other two sets of bars. The middle set of bars shows you how many misclassified people by the BLS estimation. And so in some respects, those misclassified people should be added to the first set of bars. So while the official number is 13.3, if you look at the red bar, that's roughly 3%. It's more like 16% coming down from roughly 20%. So it really shows you a very damaged labor market. That's particularly true if you also look at the next set of four bars, which show you people that want a job but are not in the labor force. So they're not actively looking because presumably they're thinking this is just not an appropriate time to get another job. And you can see the people in that situation has also risen over the last 3 months. So all three sets of these bars highlight that the labor market is badly disrupted. Next slide, please. So this breaks up the unemployment rate by age. And what's clear is no matter what age cohort you're in, this is a bad outcome for you. So the unemployment across all age cohorts have gone up. But I want to highlight the dark blue line, which is people between the ages of 16 and 24. These are the people just entering the labor market. As you can see, they've been disproportionately impacted. For those of you that have children that are graduating from high school and entering the labor market or graduating college and entering the labor market, this is a very difficult time to enter the labor market and just highlights that there are some of the groups that have been most seriously impacted, not to say that all age cohorts haven't been very badly affected by the pandemic. Next slide, please. This breaks it up by race and ethnicity. And again, you can see the dark blue line, which is the overall unemployment rate, and that has gone up. This is the same unemployment rate that you saw on the earlier chart. One of the disturbing features is that we had very low unemployment rates, which were really starting to have a big impact, particularly on minorities that traditionally have had much higher unemployment rates. So the unemployment rate for both Black and Hispanic individuals had come down quite significantly. And in February, the spread between those categories, while still too high, were closer to what the overall unemployment rate was. If you move over to the right to May, you can see that in particular, Hispanics have been particularly impacted. They tend to be in those industries that have been most severely impacted. Again, the overall unemployment rate went up, but it is quite striking how much it's fallen on minorities and how that spread between minorities and the overall continues to be quite large and unfortunately has become larger as a result of the pandemic. Next slide, please. This shows you by educational attainment. And as I highlighted in my opening remarks, the industries that have been disproportionately impacted tend to be hourly workers. Those tend to be workers with less educational attainment. So if, as you move from left to right in any one particular month, you're seeing the unemployment rate from high school, then college, started college, to bachelor's degree, to overall. And what you can see is that those individuals with only a high school diploma or less have been disproportionately impacted. So those people with less educational attainment have been severely impacted, even though people of all educational attainment have obviously seen a big step up in the unemployment rate. Next slide, please. So this provides you the forecast that members of the FOMC provide on a quarterly basis. So at our last FOMC meeting, we were asked to provide our economic forecast out through the end of this year and next year for four variables that I'm showing you here. Throughout this period, everybody was expecting the short-term interest rate to stay very close to zero. You can see that real GDP for the end of the year is expected to be minus 6.5%. That actually is a very severe recession. So when you're averaging over the four quarters, that is a very severe outcome. You can see by the 2021 median forecast that everybody is, that the median is expecting some snapback, but not a full snapback. And you really see that with the unemployment rate. The unemployment rate is 9.3% according to the median of FOMC participants. Again, not much different than what the peak was in the financial crisis. And then some improvement in the following year. But even at 6.5% unemployment rate, that's a very high unemployment. I would also highlight that the inflation expectations of the committee for what we're going to see over the next 2 years is well below the 2% that we're expecting to get over the longer run. So clearly we're missing on both unemployment and inflation. That's the reason why the Federal Reserve is following a very accommodative monetary policy. Next slide, please. Now, one of the challenges about the pandemic is it's affecting the economy in a very significant way. I would just highlight that my own forecast is actually a little weaker than that of the median FOMC members. As I said, I am expecting double-digit unemployment at the end of this year. The reason for that is that we have not been as successful in stopping community spread in the United States as has occurred in many other countries. So this just shows you both the unemployment rate and the number of COVID-19 cases per thousands of population. And what it highlights is that the United States, unfortunately, is both an outlier in unemployment and an outlier in the number of cases. Going to the other axis where you see South Korea and Japan, they've been much more successful in controlling the pandemic and have not seen as sharp an increase in unemployment. Now, I would highlight that there are differences across country, both in how they collect the COVID-19 data and how they measure unemployment. So I wouldn't take this literally, but in a qualitative sense, it just highlights that relative to many other parts of the world, we have a lot of work to do to catch up in actually both dimensions. Next chart, please. This is a somewhat complicated chart, so let me just describe it. What it's showing you is visits to restaurants and stores. So this is based on a website that tracks people's phone and looks at which locations they're going to. So it aggregates millions of phone visits and tries to look at where people are actually going. And there are three lines here. One is for non-essential retail. The orange line is for restaurants. The green line is for clothing. Let's start with the upper two panels. So you see Massachusetts and Rhode Island that are actually quite similar. So once there were school closures and we had the mandated closings, You see that visits to non-essential retail restaurants and clothing stores dropped dramatically. Similarly, that happened in Rhode Island. In both states, we've started reopening. You can see that it's been very gradual in both states. And as a result, we are not seeing that many more visits. So it's still down dramatically from what we saw in February. Turning to two states that have had a different outcome, one is South Carolina and the other is Florida. And you can see that while all four states did decline significantly in March, there's been a dramatically bigger increase across all three of those categories in South Carolina and to a somewhat lesser degree in Florida. What's really striking in South Carolina is that non-essential businesses, restaurants, and clothing are only down slightly from where they were in the beginning of March when the pandemic first really hit with a vengeance. So they're very close to what they were seeing then. Next slide, please. But this also highlights that it's come at a cost. So what this is showing you is the COVID-19 cases per millions of population. And I would highlight that the scale of the upper two are different than the scale of the lower two. For Massachusetts and Rhode Island, what you can see is we really had a severe problem in March going into April. And then we, as a result of the mandatory shutdowns and the actions taken at state and local level, we've seen some dramatic declines in infection rates in both Massachusetts and Rhode Island. And we're in a position where we're very close to where we were in early March. You can see that South Carolina and Florida are following a very different path. They didn't have the big increase in March and April, but they're starting to see a very big increase right now. If you kind of look at where they have been moving in May and the early June, they look a little bit like where Massachusetts and Rhode Island was moving towards the end of March. So this highlights that it doesn't appear that we're opening as safely as we need to, because if the trend continues in South Carolina and Florida, there will be a situation that significantly impacts people in particularly vulnerable populations. They're likely to have much more severe problems with their hospitals and may actually be forced to shut down if they overwhelm their hospitals and too many people become infected and have to be hospitalized. So if you open up quickly and without sufficient protections, what you may have done is increased employment in March and April, but decreased employment as we get into the second half of the year. So hopefully as Massachusetts and Rhode Island open up, we learn the lessons from those experiences and make sure that while it's important to open up the economy, it's important to open up the economy in a sensible and safe way. Next slide, please. So in terms of risks to the outlook, I think there's a substantial risk of reopening too fast and relaxing social distancing too much. It's inconvenient for everybody to be cooped up in their home. It's inconvenient to wear masks. It's inconvenient not to be able to easily go to stores and go grocery shopping. But I know while everybody is very excited about having all these restrictions relieved, I think it's instructive to look at what happened in some of the previous flu epidemics. So both the 1918 Spanish flu, the 57-58 Asian flu, and the avian flu H1N1 all had more severe second waves. That doesn't mean we necessarily have a more severe second wave. I think we can take actions that prevent that. But if we don't take actions to prevent that, I am much more concerned about whether the second half of the year will be as robust. And the evidence we're seeing to date with the continued community spread makes me concerned that in my baseline forecast, I'm more pessimistic than my colleagues at the FOMC that we won't continue to see very significant headwinds. Even if you're more optimistic than me about how we'll be handling the virus in the second half of the year, the median forecast highlighted that even people that are much more optimistic than me, it's still a very bad outcome and very stimulative policy for both monetary policy, and I would highlight also for fiscal policy, I think are going to be necessary. Next slide, please. So let me pivot a little bit. And so clearly I'm worried about the second half of the year. Clearly we have a severe economic outcome. One of the things that we're doing that is very non-traditional is that during the financial crisis, we did provide lending facilities that were primarily market-based facilities. So it was in effect buying marketable securities. That disproportionately helps firms that have access to financial markets, but doesn't help as much firms that don't have access to financial markets and rely on bank financing. So we're starting up a program that we've never done before. It's called the Main Street Lending Program. You can go to the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston website that's going to describe this in much more detail than I have time to describe today. Its goal is to bridge businesses and, as you'll see in a minute, nonprofit organizations who were doing well prior to the pandemic, but have been badly impacted by the effects of the pandemic and need bridges to get to a place where we get better medical outcomes and businesses restored. So the focus of the initial announcement was on bank loans to businesses. And we have just released an additional term sheet that makes us much more attractive, as I'm about to describe. I think this is an important program. It is a complex program, but it's complex for a reason, that bank loans are inherently complicated. They're an agreement between an individual bank and an individual borrower. These tend to be bespoke, which means they tailor it to the needs of the bank and the borrower. What the Federal Reserve is trying to do is try to expand the capacity to give bank loans, but do it in a standardized way. That is very complicated because that's not the way bank loans are set up. That's one reason why it's taken so long to set this up, is we've worked very closely in outreach with both borrowers and banks to get an understanding of how we could do this effectively. Next slide, please. Now, this just shows you what happens to bank lending at commercial banks in the last three recessions. So you can see the shading, and you can see that it's not unusual for bank loans to actually go down in a recession. That's particularly true if banks are constrained because they don't have sufficient capital. So you can see in the financial crisis, which is the thickest of the lines, and the 1991 recession, which particularly hit New England, bank lending did go down. That's both a demand problem and a supply problem. If you look to the far right, you can see that many businesses were very concerned that they would start losing access to financing, so they drew down their lines of credit. That's mostly larger firms, but it just highlights that many businesses are quite concerned about what credit availability will be as we get into the second half of the year. I would highlight that while banks are in very good position, there still remains quite a bit of uncertainty about what the second half of the year is going to look like. Next slide, please. So the pandemic is actually a much more severe shock than we've experienced with those other three recessions. So even with less severe recessions, there can be problems with credit crunches. But I think what's special about the pandemic is that banks understandably have to be concerned about whether economic conditions will worsen in the fall. They have to be concerned about whether a second wave will occur. And so when they're thinking about lending to businesses, they have to think about the risks to that. That means that even though they're not constrained by bank capital right now, there is the very reasonable concern that because of these risks, they're going to have to be relatively conservative. So what we're trying to do is to try to overcome some of those concerns by purchasing 95% of eligible loans, so that banks don't have to take all the risk on these loans. The Federal Reserve, as a result, is going to be taking most of the risk on the loans, but we're actually requiring banks to have a 5% stake because we want them to make an evaluation and provide loans to businesses they think have the possibility of making it to when the pandemic is less of a problem, but don't necessarily make loans to businesses that are not likely to be successful in reopening. It's also that banks may very well think that the borrower is in sufficiently good shape. There are businesses that have actually been helped by the pandemic. Think of somebody who provides personal protection equipment as an example. Those businesses probably will be relatively easy to finance in a bank and don't need to use this program. So this program is pretty specific. It's looking for borrowers and banks where the borrower has had difficulty because of the pandemic, but has a business model that will survive the pandemic. So what it's doing is providing the Federal Reserve's balance sheet to help out providing loans extended to borrowers at this very challenging time. Next slide, please. So we announced last week that we were going to make some major changes. They're all favorable to borrowers. I would particularly highlight that we reduced the minimum loan size to $250,000. What that means is that community banks are finding this a much more attractive facility, and borrowers that need only $250,000 or more can look to this program as a possible source of funding. We also increased the maximum size, and we made the terms more attractive. The loan maturity was moved from 4 to 5 years. The repayment schedule is no principal or interest the first year, no principal the second year, and a relatively low amortization schedule until the fifth year. We also made all three of the lending facilities 95%, which means that the banks only have to put up 5% for each of the loans that they're bringing to the facility. Next slide, please. Now, addition to this lending program that's focused on businesses, we also have a program that we just announced and is just at the term sheet stage, which is for nonprofit organizations. I think this is an incredibly important program. I've actually had conversations with the governor of Rhode Island about some large nonprofits, including hospitals, including higher education, and including many other nonprofits that have also been badly disrupted by the pandemic. They also are large employers all through New England. We disproportionately have these types of institutions in New England. So this is a term sheet that we're looking for comments by next Monday. If you are a nonprofit organization, I would encourage you to look at the terms of this, both for providing comments by Monday, but also for thinking about once we're live on this program, contacting banks about whether it's a good program for you. It has basically the same features as the businesses. So it's a loan term of 5 years. The principal and interest are deferred in the first year. The second year, the principal payments are also deferred. The interest is 300 basis points above LIBOR. You can see the loan sizes in the slide. Same lender participation rate of 5%, and you can prepay these loans. In the middle of a pandemic, this is actually pretty attractive financing options. So this is just out for comment. What happens when we get the comments is the Federal Reserve and the Treasury look at all of those comments. I would highlight our staff spend a lot of time trying to tailor these programs to make sure that it works for both lenders and borrowers. And in this case, it would be nonprofit organizations. So we will look at all the comments. We will then come up with a more finalized term sheet. And then hopefully we will be in a position where banks can start providing loans. And as soon as we're live with actually funding the loans, we can help the banks by funding the 95% of the loans. Next slide, please. I also want to give an update on how our lender registration. So both of the business program and the nonprofit program work through banks. So the banks are a critical link in this entire program. We opened up on Monday for lender registration. I'm very pleased to announce that already 200 financial institutions have initiated the registration process. I know many banks are spending time understanding the program, understanding the legal documents that go with the program, understanding which borrowers that it's going to be attractive for. We have registrations from both large and small firms. We have registrations from all 12 Federal Reserve districts In fact, there's no geographic concentration. So we're seeing banks from all over the country initiating the process to participate in the program. The registration does take a couple of days. The reason it takes a couple of days is once you're registered, we're going to be over time funding loans, and we want to make sure that we have the institutional information accurate, that there's no fraud involved, and that we have a way to wire funds directly to the institution. So the registration, while there are institutions that are able to register in one day, because it includes both the CEO, the CFO, and other types of affirmations, most institutions are taking multiple days to get registered. So I would strongly encourage banks that to take a hard look at this program and think about whether it could help both their businesses, but also their communities. I would highlight at this stage, we also have a large representation of community banks already. I would expect as more community banks become aware of the program and understand the details, that they will be registering over the next couple of weeks. And we also have some very sizable banks, many of them with significant representation, both in New England and elsewhere in the country. And they have started initiating the process, and we look forward to having more of those institutions register over the next couple of weeks as well. Next slide, please. So I can't encourage people strongly enough that our lenders that are on this call, that they should explore this program and see if it can be beneficial both to themselves, but also to their businesses and communities that they work in. I think it's a very important program for borrowers. I think it's going to be attractive for a wide variety of borrowers, and that is both business borrowers and nonprofit borrowers. I would also highlight that if my economic forecast is right, even if you don't think you need it right now, it's a good way to protect against the economy potentially being worse in the fall. So there is a insurance policy element of registering now, so that if you do find that you need it and you have lots of borrowers that get into difficulty as we get into the fall, it would be much better to be registered well in advance and have already gotten through the program. Banks can immediately make loans in this program. We don't yet have the funding ability. We need to have banks registered, but we're planning in the next several weeks to be able to start funding the loans that banks currently can make right now. And that will be funding the 95% of the portion of the loan that will be on the Federal Reserve's balance sheet. We're at the early days of this program. This and many other activities we're doing are trying to get the word out to both borrowers and banks. You should look at the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston website to get much more detail. We've been having a variety of lender programs, a variety of business programs. We're going to have nonprofit programs. We're going to have programs focused on minority businesses and lenders. So I would encourage people that are interested in this program to take a hard look at the program, take a look at the Boston Fed website. And if you're a lender, I would hope you'd get registered. If you're a borrower, I'd hope you'd talk with banks in your area about whether this might be an applicable program for you. I'm thrilled that we have a steady stream of interest. Each day this week, we've been seeing more and more increases of firms that are starting the registration process. I expect that to continue over the next several weeks. Next slide, please. So I know I've covered a lot of material in a short period of time. I also know I talk pretty quickly, so apologies, but I want to get through a lot of material. In terms of concluding observations, obviously everybody in the country and really everybody in the world have been hit by this pandemic. But I would highlight that the societal divisions that were already present in a good economy are clearly being exacerbated in an economy deeply troubled by what's happened with the pandemic. I think that the path of the economy is very dependent on how well we contain the virus. And it's going to be very important to get public health outcomes that contain the virus, and hopefully over time, either medical solutions or vaccines so that it no longer is a deterrent to individuals going out to businesses being able to be opened with confidence. Right now, we already have a very high unemployment rate and a very low inflation rate. So additional monetary and fiscal policy is clearly justified. I just highlight that there are a variety of programs. I have not focused on some of the security purchase programs, which if you're a larger state or if you're a larger corporation, there are a number of facilities at the New York Fed that you should take a look into. But I think the Main Street Lending Program is really focused on small and medium-sized businesses and soon nonprofit organizations. I think it's an incredibly important backstop against the pandemic. And that's particularly true if we have a difficult fall. So I'll stop there and be glad to answer any questions that Lori feeds me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. President, that was fascinating and very interesting to learn about the Main Street Lending Program. I did have a couple of questions about that, particularly the $250,000 in eligibility or minimum loan eligibility. What other eligibility standards would the banks be looking at in terms of their willingness to write at that level?
So there are several elements to the program. There are actually, without getting too technical, there are actually three programs for businesses and two programs for nonprofits. For the businesses, one of the key underwriting elements is debt to EBITDA, which is just a measure of how leveraged the institution is. I would encourage people, rather than going through the whole term sheet, I'd encourage people to look at the Boston Fed website and see all the details of the terms of lending. For the nonprofit organization, there are three different criteria that are really looking at the equivalent of what rating agencies use when they provide an evaluation of the credit ratings of nonprofit organizations. So again, there's a term sheet that lays out those details that I think are very important to look at. Our expectation is that most businesses that are small and medium-sized businesses that fit in that minimum and maximum are going to find it attractive. If you're a very highly leveraged institution, you may not qualify for the program, but there are other terms and conditions, and I would encourage people just to go to the Boston Fed website for all the details.
Mm-hmm. So generally speaking, is it fair to say that if a small business, small to medium sized business had been denied a lending facility earlier in this pandemic, that they should reapply under the terms of this new bespoke program?
So I would highlight this as very, I think you're referring to the PPP program in part. And I would highlight this is a very different program than the PPP. So the PPP program was really a grant program, which if you didn't hire back workers and meet some other criteria in that program, it was either a grant or a loan. That was extremely attractive, obviously, to any small business. This is actually a lending program. And so there are lending standards. The bank has to be willing to actually grant the loan, which means they have to make an assessment of whether they think that you will actually at some point be a solvent business able to actually make payments on the loan. So in addition to the lending standards that we've laid out to qualify, the bank has to be comfortable that you're going to be able to qualify. Borrowers cannot come directly to the Federal Reserve. They have to work through a bank. So it's important to reach out to bank lending institutions, take a hard look at the term sheet, make sure that you're an eligible borrower, and make sure that your bank is participating in the program in order to get a loan under this program. But any program with the Federal Reserve is going to be a loan. It's not a grant. Congress can do grants. We aren't a taxing authority. We can only do loans.
Could you address, going back to your presentation, what you would observe as the impact on the commercial real estate market with so many large employers now determining for their employment base that the work from home model might continue into post, you know, January and perhaps even continue longer thereafter? What do you see the impact of the commercial real estate sector in terms of the overall growth of the economy?
So the commercial real estate sector, like many sectors of the economy, has been significantly impacted by the pandemic. You highlighted office as one element of the commercial real estate. That is an area that's going through significant change. I know from my own organization, we're thinking about space very differently. We're thinking about how we can get workers safely back into the organization, how we can make sure that there's enough space, that we have protection against the pandemic if it persists, so that workers can come into the building. The Federal Reserve building has an elevator. You have to think about how people get up and down in elevators. You have to think about how people get food services. So there's a lot of work to be done to be able to open up a building. So I think there are two countervailing elements. In some respects, we're going to need more space per worker, but probably businesses are going to have more workers at home. That's a model that the Boston Fed will certainly be following. I think it's too soon to know exactly how that plays out. I do think that it's going to be very important for landlords and businesses to be quite adaptable. Until we get to the point in the pandemic where people are willing to take mass transit, where people are willing to get on elevators, I think it's unlikely that many businesses are going to have people completely back into the office. In terms of other sectors of the real estate sector, I think there's some challenges there as well. If you're running a warehouse, I see an Amazon truck on my street almost every day. So if you're a warehouse, you probably are a sector that's actually benefited from the disruptions from the pandemic. If you're somebody who's living in a city, I think many cities and many citizens of cities are thinking a little bit differently about what the benefits of being in a city versus a suburb are. I am noticing in my own suburb, which is halfway between Boston and Providence, homes seem to be moving pretty quickly despite the pandemic. And I think that's a reflection of people rethinking whether they want to be in downtown situations if this pandemic persists. So I think it's too soon to know how it's going to affect all elements of real estate. We do have much lower interest rates. That certainly helps borrowers if you're a new home loan borrower or if you're refinancing. But I think real estate, like other sectors of the economy, are going to have to be quite adept at making sure that they pivot as both firms and individuals think differently about real estate.
You mentioned that you had spoken with Governor Gina Raimondo of Rhode Island. Could you tell us a little bit about that conversation, and also if you could touch on a major sector of the Rhode Island economy, which is the manufacturing sector, and how you feel that sector will continue to recover, and whether or not you believe that this will be a source of greater productivity out of manufacturing, given the fact that many companies may wish to have their supply chains closer to home.
Yeah, well, my comments with the governor are private, but let me highlight that she was interested in making sure that these facilities were broadly available to borrowers in Rhode Island. And there are a number of facilities that may at some point be attractive to citizens, firms, and actually the government of Rhode Island. We do have a municipal finance facility. It is not that attractive for most states right now, including Rhode Island. But if the pandemic were to get worse, it might become a more attractive facility in the fall. For the businesses, she was concerned that we made it attractive to make sure that businesses could have access to needed credit. And she really highlighted the importance that nonprofit organizations play in the state. And I assured her that we were working very diligently on getting a nonprofit term sheet, which in my remarks I've highlighted, we've just gone out for comment. So I think all the things that I discussed with her, I've actually covered in my talk. I think it was a very productive discussion, and always welcome comments from any of the governors of New England about how the pandemic's affecting them and how we can tailor some of our Federal Reserve programs. In terms of manufacturing, I think many manufacturing businesses are going to fit into the Main Street program. They are the types of organizations where they have been disrupted by the pandemic, but very well may expect that they'll be able to produce in a safe way as we get into the summer and fall, and need both national and global markets to come back, but may very well have a business model that works quite well. In talking to banks and borrowers, many banks and borrowers have highlighted that manufacturing firms might be attracted to the Main Street lending facility. I do think that manufacturing, like all businesses, have to think about how to structure things so that it's safe. There are obviously, for example, in food processing, a number of industries that have had significant problems with the pandemic. But I think it's just a warning to all businesses that we have to be very careful about bringing workers back in a way that is safe for everybody.
Interesting. Interested in your thoughts on the extension of unemployment insurance benefits, the additional $600 per week. The Fed chair earlier this week did come out and call for additional continuation of those benefits. How do you titrate, if you will, the need for additional unemployment and then the ability and the desire of employers to bring back a workforce?
So it's incredibly important that we support both individuals and businesses that have been affected by this disruption. I know Congress is negotiating another round of support. I'm apolitical, so I don't get involved in the nitty-gritty of the politics involved in how that legislation is actually crafted. I would refer you to Congress and senators. They're in a much better position to advocate for how that next bill should evolve. I would say, though, that just in a general sense, I do think that we're going to need more support, and that's particularly true if the fall ends up being more troubling than we all hope it is. We were all hoping this would be a couple months and the problem would, in effect, go away. I think we're all realizing that this is going to be with us much longer than we had hoped. And that's going to be a continuing headwind. And that means that many businesses and many individuals are going to be disproportionately impacted. Congress is the only one that can actually provide grants that help support those organizations. So I think that they should think expansively about the best way to support those that are most vulnerable to the pandemic.
Mm-hmm. And to that point, and this will be our last question, I was particularly interested in your slides where you talked about the disproportionate impact of 16 to 24 year olds relative to job loss. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are in terms of downstream impact later in life as individuals starting their career, the delays in starting a career and delays in savings and investing and savings, you know, on 401ks. You know, and also, you know, those individuals, summer jobs for kids. So both at, you know, throughout the continuum, summer jobs for kids, kids at very entry level, jobs at entry level places, but also professional jobs where young people will indeed have to delay their professional entry.
As you highlight, this is a very, very challenging situation for somebody coming into the labor market. Economists have done a lot of studies showing that if you come out of high school or college and into the labor market during a recession, your outcomes through life are actually impacted. That's because you don't get the requisite business experience that you would have gotten in the absence of the recession occurring. That's why it's so critically important that monetary and fiscal policy bring the unemployment rate down as fast as we possibly can, while we get the right public health outcomes so that we can contain the virus so businesses can get back to business as usual. So this is a very serious problem. I know a number of New England colleges are working with their alumni to try to make sure that they can try to hire some of these individuals. I think any programs that we have to help individuals make that transition, it's a very difficult time because many businesses actually are furloughing workers right now. And so even though young workers entering the job market are disproportionately impacted, I also don't want to diminish the fact that many people have also lost their jobs and are going to be looking for new jobs. So that's why we can't let up. It's very expensive for fiscal policy to provide the support. It's a very challenging environment for monetary policy to be opening up these programs. I have a large segment of my workforce at the Boston Fed who've been working 7 days a week for much more than 8 hours a day to try to set up some of these emergency facilities. So it's not sustainable, and I know it's not sustainable for many people working in many businesses and many nonprofits, but we just need to work through it. This is a serious shock to our economy, a serious shock to the global economy, and I think that we do need to think about ways that we can reemploy people as quickly as possible, including those workers just entering the job market.
Thank you very much for that. And I do want to just mention as we close out, Mr. President, and draw your attention to the fact that there are some really valuable and significant efforts going on in Rhode Island right now to address this very issue in terms of young people and granting them various summer internships, specifically for students in high school. So the business community has been, very generous and eager to work with groups like Skills for Rhode Island's Future, which was incubated by the Chamber a number of years ago, to continue to provide paying internship opportunities for now students in high school, in addition to providing college internships. So that, in fact, may be one way to bridge the skills gap and to keep those students having their skills be accelerated, sharpened, and developed over the course of not just the summer, but perhaps during continued fallow times. So that concludes our time together, Mr. President. I just want to thank you so very much. You've been wonderful to speak with us today. You are no stranger to the Greater Providence Chamber of Commerce. You were with us in November at our annual meeting, and you have been with us many, many, many times before, providing thoughts and also gathering feedback from the members of the Greater Providence Chamber and providing input to you on data and trends and other things, and also working with us on important issues like childcare and the like. So we thank you for your time. We thank you for your interest in Rhode Island, and our various platforms remain open to you, goes without saying, at any point that you wish to come back and have further interactions with the members of the Rhode Island business community. So thank you again, and thank you to everybody who took the time to log on to this particular session. I know it was very informative, and we will look forward to working with all of our banks and financial institutions in Rhode Island to get the Mainstream Lending Program very well known and amplified. So thank you again.
Thank you. I appreciate all your support and help.